The municipal buildings are full of statues of full-sized people, heads, animals, and fabulous beasts. I feel that there have not been many guides that fully appreciate or even understand what the sculptures mean or had meant to the Victorians who carved and placed them there for us. The building has three main sides that are worth exploring, and I plan to explore in this walk the north face and its town hall facade, the west face with its north tower, and then the south face of the buildings with its main entrance, and to finish with a description of the Victoria Tower and its interesting decorations, starting with the north face. In the original plans in 1879, the north face was meant to be utilitarian with simple purposes such as a police station, an entrance to the back of the town hall, and a fire station. In fact, when the competition plans were submitted in 1879, they only showed drawings of the west face, the south face, and the tower, not a detailed plan of the north face. When the council finally realised part of the plan could not be built due to the Cowan's Corner dispute in 1882, they knew they had to modify the original plan. This was about 2 to 3 years into the building programme. It was good news and bad news. The bad news was the plan would be incomplete without Cowan's Corner. The good news was that the corporation could use the Cowan's Corner's budget to enhance the rest of the building and the tower. So they added many feet to the tower, going from 150 feet to 245 feet. They introduced the two corner towers on the west face and placed four much more elaborate pediments on the west and south faces. The third beneficiary was the back entrance to the town hall. What was created was an elaborate and very attractive facade that slotted in between the faces of the police station and the fire station and lined everything up elegantly. The police building has at the top of its entrance two large statues that catch your eye at once. The large statues are of a lawyer or writer, as they were known in those days, and a judge in full array. The world globe is placed under their pedestal, and two lions are on each side of it. Under them is a delicate archway full of thistles to clearly state this is Scottish law. The four sculpted heads at the level of the first floor are there to help you work out if you are in the right place to get what you want from the council. The first lady with a pipe for a necklace shows us your sanitation questions are addressed here. The next lady is a representative for the town's cleansing services. The gentleman with the entwined snake around his head tells you a doctor is present in the police office. And the last gentleman wearing chains around his neck and a padlock in his hair says there are police cells in the building that he is the guardian of. The middle section of the north face is an elegant facing built with Cowan Corner money to create a better image of the back of the building for passers-by. It has some of the best detailed figures and also sets out to show off Greenock's outlook to the world. The facade is divided into five bays by four enormous Corinthian cap pillars. At the topmost level, there are five friezes above the third floor windows. There are four little people in each frieze, and by their activities, they can be given a theme. In the order from left to right, there is firstly science, then industry, navigation, agriculture, art and music. Below the friezes and above each column, there is a half-dressed colossal male figure. The four of them represent the first of three portrayals of the four known continents that you will see on the buildings. In the 1880s, in their eyes, there were only four continents in the world, and Australia was left out. Left to right, these four gentlemen are Europe, Asia, Africa, and the Americas. Below the men, and at the top of each column, are three women's heads. They are the second representation of the four continents, and are in the same order as the men: Europe, Asia, Africa, and the Americas. As in the police station, there are two heads at first floor level of the town hall facade that are there to guide you. The main entrance to the town hall for the public was from the south, but artists and staff had to come into the rear of the town hall. So we have a male entrance and a female entrance, each using separate back stairs. In the third section of the north face, we had the fire station. There are two friezes above the second floor windows. One of them is a little girl who seems to be holding on grimly, while in the other frieze, a chubby little fireman is directing his hose to save her. As in the police station and the town hall facade, there are heads above the double doors to help guide you. The first is a lady with barrels and bales around her neck. This is the place for harbour administration. The middle gentleman undoubtedly is a fireman with his helmet, and this is the fire station. The lady to the right has chains around her neck and a yoke in her hair. She is helping you to the transport administration. The west face is dominated by the North Tower. This stands proudly on the corner. It has unique statues and a mystery. As you go up from the roof level, you meet a giant of a male statue as he seems to struggle with the load above him. The giant man could be Samson or Atlas or even Daniel the prophet. Above him is a truly mysterious animal or beast. Who or what is this beast? The mysterious beast has a lion's head with what looks like small horns, eagle's wings, a man's body and legs, and a breastplate. This bizarre figure is known as a tetramorph. This is a being made up of four elements. Similar tetramorphs have been created in Egyptian and Greek and Babylonian cultures. In Greenock's case, it represents the four Christian evangelists based on the scheme put forward by Jerome in the 5th century AD. The lion's head is St. Mark. The man's body is St. Matthew. The horns on the lion's head represents the ox of St. Luke, and the eagle wings would be St. John. The breastplate is the breastplate of righteousness. With this Christian interpretation, the giant below seems more likely to be Samson. Higher up the tower are niches for four statues, two of which are unoccupied. I call the occupied ones for now Statue 1 and Statue 2. They each have a tetramorph and a Samson underneath them. I do have a good idea who they are, and I will reveal that later. The next decorations on the west side are the two pediments with rich sculptures. I said before there was a change from the original plans to enhanced plans because of Cowan's Corner. Each of the two pediments on the west face has deeply carved friezes with four busy workers. One frieze I interpret as industry, and the second as navigation. There are four ladies and two angels supporting each of the friezes, and some of them carry appropriate objects that are related to the theme above, such as a lighthouse for the navigation frieze. The west face had two main entrances. There was an entrance to the houses that were originally built into the buildings for revenue, and the public entrance to the town offices. As you can see, there is a lot of features on the west face and a lot that is missing. Over the public entrance door, there is a lady riding a horse-drawn chariot over the waves. She could be Amphitrite, the wife of Poseidon, god of the seas. She has above her two friezes that can be interpreted as industry and agriculture. In the upper corner of the large windows on both the west face and the south face, there are heads of women in particular style. They do not appear to represent more than womanhood. To be noted is that each lady seems to have a different hairstyle. There is a long covered passageway that was meant to go from Cathcart Square to Taylor's Close and then on to the Low Vennel. It also gives access to the front door of the town hall. The symbol above the west entrance is a Viking ship heading towards you with large fish as escorts. We have talked about the changes forced on the council by Cowan's Corner. There were more dramatic changes to the south face because of the Second World War. The building was damaged in 1941, and the south tower and the two south-facing pediments were very badly damaged and had to be removed. The south tower was built shorter than the north tower because of the slope of the ground. Seen from the west in an old picture, it is decorated by at least three statues and empty niches. There are fine decorations over these empty niches. These three statues on the tower faced out to the town. The man on the left has his left hand resting on a hoe. He perhaps represents agriculture. The man in the middle view is clearly someone with a science background and has a quadrant in his hand and a globe by his side. There is a tantalizing glimpse of the third man facing towards Cathcart Square. He appears to be a soldier with his right hand resting on the hilt of his sword, which is on his left side. There are few pictures of lost pediments on the south face up close. The following gives reasonable clarity, but the interpretation of the friezes is given with caution. The art and music interpretation given to the left frieze is based on the left frieze having a child in its centre playing a lute, perhaps. The science interpretation on the right frieze is from a child pointing up to the heavens, similar to the friezes on the North Town Hall facade. The south face arcade was meant to be occupied by a variety of shops for additional revenue. At the west end of the south face, there were two archways decorated by men and women who have various products displayed behind them. One is of two men with perhaps wheat and sugarcane. The second is of two women with vines and flowers, a sort of advert of what you could buy in the shops. The grand main entrance has been placed in the south face in Hamilton Street. It was an entrance for dignitaries and visits of royalty. It is decorated by various sculptures. Above the doorway, in the spandrels of the arches, are sculptured figures representing science and art. Above them is a round shield that shows off the town's arms, surrounded by two seahorses. Above all is a seated man with a winged hat that the architect said was the portrayal of commerce. Like the north face, the architects wanted their sculptures of heads to portray more than just a fine profile. There are four ladies' heads that are placed at the first floor level at both sides of the main entrance that are meant to inform visitors what Greenock is all about. One lady represents fishing, as she has in her hair fish and round her neck a net. The second lady, I think, represents rope making, as she has ropes in her hair. The third lady is for shipbuilding, as she has a gauge in her hair and round her neck hammers and a gear wheel. The fourth lady represents overseas trade, as she has a boat in her hair and an anchor round her neck. Just to finish the south face, there is a show of protection from the many lions placed high up on the building. Now to move on to the Victoria Tower. The tower was the heart of the concept of the municipal buildings. The buildings were to be located in a very busy town centre and needed to stand out with an obvious landmark. The tower is this landmark. It was originally meant to be 150 feet in height, but when the Crown's Corner dispute put an end to the fully balanced plan and Glasgow had made clear its plans for its city chambers, a fresh look at Greenock's plan prompted the view that the tower needed to be taller and more prominent than Glasgow's tower. It was. The replanned tower was decorated by various statues and friezes, though some are difficult to see now without binoculars. The total height of the Victoria Tower is 245 feet. The foundation of the tower needed to be 13 feet in depth and 40 feet square. It is built of brickwork and fire brick blocks set in Portland cement. The foundation ceremony was carried out with pomp and circumstance. In the archway at the base of the tower, there is a frieze with many creatures, but no fish or insects. It seems to be there to remind you of the rural life around Greenock, whilst you are in the middle of a busy town. Someone has labelled the frieze as the Greenock Zoo. There are two languid ladies resting in the archway. Their clothes are Greek because despite their laid-back poses, they are powerful, virgin Greek goddesses. The lady on the left with the torch is Hecate, who had power over birth, life and death. On the right, with her snowy owl companion, is Athena, who gifted Athens the olive tree and was strong, independent, powerful and wise. These qualities are being celebrated here. High above the archway, there is a frieze of a crew of young men in a sailing boat facing the Cathcart Square. The Greenock weather has not been kind to them, as erosion of the stone they are made of has coarsened their features almost to grotesque. A possible explanation why they are here may be the reliance of Greenock on herring fishing and the use of Dutch-style buses manufactured in Scott's shipyard since 1712. Above the frieze is an unusual scene. It is not unusual that we have an angel standing proud with wings outstretched. This angel may be Gabriel, the guardian angel. What is unusual is the two gentlemen sprawling in front of the angel in a very casual pose. These do not seem the poses of town councillors or provosts, so who could these gentlemen be? The radical thought that comes to mind is that this is a representation of the two architects, Hugh and David Barclay. Even more of a radical thought is that we may have seen them before. This would be in the North Tower, where Statue 1 and Statue 2 stand proud, carrying implements an architect or stonemason may carry. In the aftermath of the redesign of the project caused by Cowan's Corner difficulties and the lack of Greenock candidates for statues, the architects perhaps were recognised and immortalised. Hugh and David Barclay made a lasting impression elsewhere around Greenock and Port Glasgow. They were busy architects and supplied their services to many projects in what is now Inverclyde. At the top of the tower below the dome is the third representation of the four continents. These are four female personifications. They are Europe, Americas, Asia and Africa. They are difficult to make out being so high. They stand at each corner of the tower and have been sculpted to show native dress and features. So finally I arrive at the end of this journey around Greenock's municipal buildings. I hope it has given you a new perspective on these amazing buildings. I want to state here that I was encouraged by my partners in the Cottage Identity Group in Greenock. I also would like to acknowledge two missing friends, John Macquarie and Walter Pollock, and their love of our past. I leave you, who have got this far, a modern view of the two great projects that Greenock took on and succeeded in during the 1880s. They were the James Watt Dock Project and the Municipal Buildings Project. Godspeed, Greenock.